So, Ben, how is programming a social activity?
Programming is it's something we think about as sort of an individual activity. You know, you sit in front of a screen, you type a lot of code. But one of the things that Fitz and I have been talking about for a few years now is that we think of it as a team sport. And in fact, it's if you want to be a successful programmer, it helps to have that attitude in mind and think about working with other people. You want to expound on that a little?
Well, I mean, you'll sit down and write code often by yourself, but there are hardly any software projects out there that are just written by one person. So you got to work with other people, and you have to talk to them, determine who's writing what, who's doing what. Despite the fact that people don't want to admit it, communication is a huge part of that. And if you don't know how to communicate well and communicate efficiently with your team members, you wind up duplicating effort. Or, you know, you can lock yourself in your private little office and write code for 2 days, but if it's the wrong code, it doesn't matter. You know, working with other people, you really want to get a tight feedback loop. So write something, get some them to review it, talk to them about it, etc. And you sort of repeat that the same way that you compile code as you're writing it. Mm-hmm. It's a tight feedback loop.
And so one of the things we're actually talking about and what we've been focused on is if programming is a team sport and you're going to be working with other people, what is the best way to build a culture within your team that facilitates communication? And that culture is a really important part of how you write code. It affects everything you do and how efficient you are.
So what is mass organizational manipulation?
It's my specialty. So organizational manipulation is what I talk about as the way of, it's a way of navigating a complex organizational structure. Okay, if you look at any company, whether any company has more than one person in it, mm-hmm. and the org chart doesn't necessarily match the way that power flows within the organization, and it doesn't necessarily match how you go about getting things done. If you need to get software shipped, or you need to get something signed off on, or just make things happen. So I jokingly refer to that as a way of working through any organization to get things done. You know, having worked at Google for 6 years now, you know, it's grown just a little bit since that, in that time.
That was just my two cents in watching you is it helps, I think, to become friends with executive assistants. They have a lot more power than people realize, right. And that's my pro tip.
is that the key? Be friendly with executive assistants.
I just think that's an example of sure. Sort of where the org chart doesn't necessarily match the power chart or the right. The way of getting things done.
Right.
Just one particular example.
I see. Okay.
Yeah, that is an example. And beyond that, it's just sort of knowing what to do and knowing when to ask permission and when to do what you think is right. Mm-hmm. And it helps if you're in a company where it's okay to do what's right. And then ask, you know, beg. At least we talk about begging for forgiveness, not asking for permission.
Sure.
And I think it's a very efficient way of getting your work done. But I will point out that sometimes begging for forgiveness involves like skinning up your knees as you're groveling across the parking lot, right? Even if it is, yeah. And I've done it, but it was worth it. Right. Totally worth it.
So, Fitz, I had a question for you. What impact have you seen from Google's data liberation front?
Well, you know. Gosh, if you'd asked me that a month ago, I'd have been like, you know, I think I've seen some impact in the tech world. It wasn't until we launched Google Takeout last month that the impact it increased by, I'd say, orders of magnitude. There's a couple different sides of the impact. One is within the company. And, you know, whenever we talk to people, we always get basically enthusiastic response from people. They're like, this is a great idea. Let's do this. And how can we make it go better? Mm-hmm. And then after we initially launched in 2009, the people we spoke to were all like, yeah, this is a fabulous idea. It's a way of explaining how we intend to compete and how we intend to keep users by innovation as opposed to building bigger locks. But we never really, I'd say, got a big hit in the consumer side of things. But since we've launched Takeout, I think people suddenly see, hey, this is really innovative way of doing this. You can pull a bunch of your products in at once and download them, and we're adding products as time goes on. But I think people realize that, hey, this is a real stand. It's a real commitment to the data liberation mm-hmm. sort of philosophy. And I won't be happy until consumers are demanding it from Google, from other companies, before they start putting their data into a product.
Right. So last question, Ben, this one's for you. There's no segue between that and this one, but it's relevant
sure.
to the session, one of the sessions you have. I was interested in, how do you see mobile devices actually shaping interactive fiction?
So interactive fiction is one of those interesting hobbies, I suppose. So in the 1980s, it was a really big form of gaming. Mm-hmm. most people think it died in the 1980s, and in fact, it really just went underground. It's sort of an indie developer community. And it's been going very strong, especially in the last 10 years. And just in terms of the state of the technology, the state of the art, it's just been known only to a small group of sort of an independent community. Mm-hmm. And what makes me excited about mobile devices is that I feel like the stage is being set to bring this medium back into the mainstream. Everyone's got a little tiny computer in their pocket now, right? Before, when we just had laptops or big computers on our desk, why would we want to play a game that was essentially all text, mm-hmm. right? I mean, you've got giant screens and giant graphics, what a waste, right? But now you've got small computers in your pocket, which there's sort of a renaissance in small, simple games, people rediscovering them, right? All the madness over how many games can you get from the App Store, right? Mm-hmm. None of them are as sophisticated, typically, as what you get on a big machine, but smaller games are getting very popular, and even retro is becoming cool in some ways. Mm-hmm. And then combine that with the movement of the general movement of the industry towards electronic books, right? Everyone's reading books on their phones, on their e-readers. And so if you pose interactive fiction, is what a lot of us are thinking, is that you can mix the two together. You say, look, this is fiction. You read your books on your e-book reader. Here's a different kind of book that's interactive, right? It's a real piece of fiction. And it's kind of like a game, too, and we know you love to play games on your phone. So here's this perfect thing to do while you're sitting on the subway, right? It's just, I think we're going to bring it back into the consciousness of the mainstream. That's my hope, and some other folks I work with.
Great. So. Well, thanks so much for being with us, guys. Appreciate it.